And as you probably know, I've been a huge Cure fan. I've probably got more Cure records in my collection than any other artiste or band. So anyway, phone calls backwards and forwards, and eventually Roger, Simon, Robert, Jason and Perry are here. The Cure, welcome. Thank you very much indeed.
Hello.
It's lovely to see you all, it really is. I've been trying to work out how long ago since we last saw each other. I think it's about 6 years or something.
Yeah, we last met in the 90s. I'm not sure that you...
95, I think.
It's been a lot longer since you met as a band, though.
Yeah, so I think it was Finsbury Park.
Yeah, that, right at the start of the 90s.
Gosh. So, The Cure, Greatest Hits. What's that all about? Is it the end of The Cure?
I don't think so, no. It should be, traditionally. I'd always felt that if we ever reached the point where there was a Greatest Hits with The Cure's name on it, it would signify the end. But I don't think this does at all. It's much more to do with the fact that we chose not to re-sign with the various majors at this point after the release of Bloodflowers. And certain labels have only got the back catalogue for a certain period of time, so it's a commercially driven release. But one which we've sort of taken control of and put new songs on and done a free acoustic CD along with it. So it's something to enthuse about.
It's such a treat, that, because you get the Greatest Hits, but then you get the acoustic versions, as you say. And we were just dancing around our house listening to this for absolutely hours.
Yes, we were. And wasn't it good fun?
Wasn't it, Robert? Wasn't it? Should we get into some music and talk some more in a moment? What are you going to play first?
Well, we'll do the first one off it. Boys Don't Cry.
Great.
As it's we'll go all the way back to the beginning.
Radio 2, and that is Boys Don't Cry. 22 years old, that track now.
Well, and a bit.
and a bit.
Yeah, we've just done this microsite for the Greatest Hits album, and there's demos to pretty much every song on there, and the original demo to that's 77.
Good grief.
Yeah.
So with the Greatest Hits, you do the acoustic version as well. Why did you do that? Because it would be very easy to just go, well, you
know, because we're naturals, aren't we? You can't just hear. we just drip acoustic.
No, but why did you do that? Because, as I say, it'd be very easy to go, well, here's a pile of hits, go and buy it.
Well, because we knew that we'd built up an awful lot of good will with the fans on the back of Blood Flowers, and particularly the tour last year. It was fantastic. I mean, probably the most consistently good shows that we've ever done as a band. And we realised that the last thing anyone's going to want is another compilation. I mean, we've done two singles compilations, so Greatest Hits is not really the most exciting thing in the world, to be honest, for a Cure fan. I think it's a, you know, I haven't put it all together, it's actually something I think we're all proud of, but we wanted to make it a little bit more special, I suppose, and putting a couple of new songs on, it's still a little bit of a marketing thing, you know, buy it and you get the two new songs, it's not really enough. So the free CD idea was something that was it was part of the deal, you know, we agreed to it if we could have the free CD. We didn't really know what to do with it at first, and the many things we could have done with it, you know, remixes, reinterpretations, fake B-sides, an endless list of foodie things. But the acoustic thing is just, it's an insight into, you know, it's just us playing. It's kind of, and the acoustic disc itself is, it's just
like
there.
This. Yeah.
Well, it's slightly better than this.
And as you say, two new tracks on there, which are Cut Here and Just Say Yes, and Saffron appears on Just Say Yes.
Yeah.
How did that come about, this duet?
Well, we did Just Say Yes as a demo for the Blood Flowers album, which is pretty hard to believe, because the reason why it didn't get on, because it didn't really fit. I'm always worried that when we do an album that's like going to be full of big songs, which Cure albums are always driven by the idea of doing big atmospheric songs, that there's sometimes a need to have something to kind of like the light in with the shade. And Just Say Yes was designed, or it was intended to be that, but never made it. But I always thought there was a good pop song in there. So when we wanted to do a couple of new songs that had to live with the Greatest Hits, Just Say Yes was a pretty obvious choice. But it had never worked for me. It was just, I really sounded like I was crying. I was like imploring Just Say Yes, rather than kind of enthusing and like pushing you towards the edge. I was saying, like, please don't go there. So I needed something or someone to kind of just make me kind of, you know, pep up, and Saffron was that person.
What a great phrase.
I knew her vaguely. I guessed that she would be vivacious based on what she did with Republica, and the few times I'd spoken to her, she seemed always like very kind of upbeat. And no, it worked. It was good. It's quite funny actually doing a duet.
Well, you actually said you did a was it somebody's wedding where you played and she came and did it, and she was dancing around, and
no, that's the cut. It's a premonition.
Was that something else? Sorry, was that a premonition? Right, okay.
That's Cure 2010.
What was the story about her?
She's performed with us once. We went over to Paris a couple of weeks ago, and no, it's Ray Coakes you're thinking of. We played at Ray Coakes' wedding. We have a history of doing weddings only for Ray Coakes. So if he ever gets remarried, I'm sure we'll do a second one. Not that he will. She came home and did it live. It's just weird having we've done something before with an outsider in inverted commas. We did Wrong Number with Reeves Gabrels, Bowie's guitarist. Mm. It was slightly different though. He joined in, you know, it's kind of a bit more of a background thing. With Saffron, you know, she's sort of there with a mic. It's odd. I mean, it's funny, I think. It took, in a strange way, it took me back to being in the Banshees, just kind of seeing someone jumping about in the corner of my eye, thinking like, can they please stop?
Well, let's have some more music. What are you going to do now?
I think we're going to attempt a song called In Between Days.
Oh, great. The Cure live on Radio 2, Roger, Simon, Robert, Jason and Perry, with me, Janice Long. And how's the reception been here to the Greatest Hits album coming out? Because I know, just looking on website, Rolling Stone, you know, still buzzing about The Cure, describe you as one of the most exciting and innovative bands still, you know, going. And you've done lots of American press and radio. Is the reception the same here?
I think we've always struggled a little bit in the UK, certainly for the past probably 7 or more years. The perception is different of the band outside of the UK. It's weird. We're kind of taking more of what we do rather than who we are and what we are supposed to represent. And the UK media have kind of put us in a position, and they're always constantly trying to like reinforce that position and justify their attitude towards us. It's that it's not me, you know, the conspiratorial side of my nature. It's just we find whenever we leave the UK, it's kind of, it's so different. You know, there's an audience for us in the UK. It's just that the media is much more difficult, so I haven't really bothered this time. I don't think that I've done a single interview, actually. We've done a couple of TV things, and now we're on Radio 2.
Yeah.
But it does, you know, I've always thought, actually, from an early age, that what we do is aimed at people who empathise with us and like us around the world. It's not to do with being English or being in the UK, so, you know, it's not that upsetting. I think if we relied on this country to vindicate what we do, to justify what we do, to enhance what we do, we'd be struggling. But no, it's nice. I mean, it's still nice to have an audience here. It's just that, which we, you know, like I say, we do have. It's just that the media itself has kind of got a bit of a downer on a band called The Cure.
The Cure. Are you still excited by the music industry?
I don't have ever been excited by the music industry, actually. It's the worst part of what we do. I've noticed more and more how difficult it is for any decision to be made that isn't a purely commercial decision. It's incredibly difficult now to get anything done with any of the majors without there being some kind of margin. Mm. You know, it's weird. In the old days, when we started, things were a lot more fractured, you know, and there couldn't be this kind of like this coherent marketing which goes on now. It was more, you know, we'd used to go to countries and we'd play, and if they liked us, we got on. Whereas now, it's much more to do with them, you know, advertising, marketing, placement, all the rest of it, which it doesn't really suit what we do, but we kind of have always existed peripherally to that, sort of in the shadows, and you know, it's fine. It's I think it suits what the band does a lot better than them. From time to time we've endured that sort of spotlight, but and it's funny when it happens, but I think it's nicer for us to make music that's just slightly away from the mainstream.
So what comes after this, then, in terms of the music? Have you got a whole box full of stuff, ideas that are ready to go, or, you know, have you got to start from scratch, or what?
A box of musical frogs. I think the next thing that will probably happen with the band is that we'll go in and record something new. But in the interim period, it will be surprising to me if some kind of B-sides collection or anthology of some sort doesn't come out first. Because I think there should be a companion piece to The Greatest Hits, because it doesn't really tell anywhere near the whole story. For most bands, I mean, if you bring out a Greatest Hits, you listen to it and you think, yep, that's what that band does. But with The Cure, it's kind of, you know, we've led this weird double life that the singles are like one thing we do, but most of what we do isn't on this album.
We've got the darkest hits.
Yeah.
Yes, the darkest hits.
Greatest misses.
Yeah. And will you tour this album?
No. The Bloodflowers tour last year was so good that we still remember the promotional stuff we did around Galore, which was the second singles collection in 97, and that wasn't very enjoyable, I don't think, for any of us. We played very few of these songs on stage last year, so I think it's an indication that the band isn't really into some of the older singles. I think it would feel weird if we were on stage now, particularly in the current climate as well. I'm really pleased that we decided not to do anything. I think it would be strange. I mean, it's you know, it's all right doing this kind of thing, doing something quite intimate, but I think getting on stage and jumping around to Let's Go to Bed and Mike at IBU in front of an audience would be slightly strange for us.
What about, I mean, would you give up music completely, or is that always going to be there?
At the drop of a hat.
Would you, Robert?
No, I would never give up. I don't think any of us would. I don't think it's really, it's one of those funny things. If you're in a band and you really like playing music, or you just like music. Mm. It's only a consideration that you ever think about. It's actually when the question is posed by someone. I don't think there is otherwise, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, could it be easy to sort of drift into that, I can't be bothered today, and then just not doing it and finding yourself watching more movies and reading more books?
No, I think there's a level of, in music, if you, anyone can make music. If you want to, it's pretty easy just to pick up an instrument and learn how to play it, or you don't even have to learn an instrument nowadays. I think it's making music for public consumption has become easier, and you know, you kind of have to have a certain ability, then you can kind of record things, you can go in front of people and play. You can't get an audience. It doesn't matter how, you know, you can buy an audience actually nowadays, but it's kind of, you have to have an awful lot of money to get there. You have to get your song played on the radio so often to convince people it's good. Generally speaking, it's that part of what the band does that I think is the part that we'd all feel we were giving up if we stopped. It's just the audience part of it. I don't think any of us would ever stop playing. Mm. I can't imagine it. It would just, you would wonder, you know, why? I mean, I still, it's very rare that a day will go by that I don't just sit down and play something on a guitar, which I always have.
And what about listening to you know, other people's stuff? Who's really impressed you recently?
This is where I'm put on the spot, though. Yeah. As the spokesman for the band, I don't think I can safely say that any one band has impressed us all. I'm getting all scowls and shaking head. If I say someone, then everyone's going to like shout. Like,
what have you bought recently or blagged?
I never blag. I always buy. Come on. I pay for everything. I'm a man of integrity. I personally think that Mogwai are the best band around at the moment, of the younger generation of bands. And I like the Deftones, I think they're really good. And I've got into Korn recently as well.
Have you?
Yeah, I think I'm drifting into new metal slowly. Just sort of worrying.
Are you going to do another track then for me? For us,
yes.
Me,
we know you're pretending this is going out.
I know your producer is just as much a fan as you are. Jack.
I know. Look at her. She's. I have to say, Sam Kennedy, my producer, cannot believe. She said, "If anybody had said to me a few years ago, you're going to sit in a studio with The Cure, I'd have said to them, I'm not." And she just can't believe it.
And if anyone says to her after this, you're going to do it again, she'll say, I'm not.
I'm definitely not.
She's really pleased that you told us that.
All right, and this is something, we don't do this one very often, so good luck, everyone. This is called High. go.
Oh yes, that's The Cure. And hi, Roger, Simon, Robert, Jason, Perry. Thank you all so much. Honestly, it's fantastic having you here. Lovely. And
thank you very much,
I hope I'll see you in the not too distant future. Don't leave it so long. All the best.
Okay, thank you very much. Cheers.